Hello everyone, this is Dr. Aditi for Ra Online. Today, in our fifth lesson in our respiratory system module, we are going to learn about two separate but vastly correlated entities, one being bronchiectasis and the other being cystic fibrosis, which is predominantly characterized by bronchiectasis. So let us look at one after another and let's start with bronchiectasis. Now, what is bronchiectasis? Bronchiectasis is a syndrome of irreversible airway dilatation. So it is similar to COPD in that this is also going to be irreversible, unlike asthma where there is going to be a reversible process. But this is different to asthma and COPD in that here this is going to be characterized by an irreversible airway dilatation. Whereas in asthma and COPD, there is going to be airway obstruction, which is going to be reversible in asthma and irreversible in COPD. So here bronchiectasis is an irreversible airway dilatation. The involvement may either be focal, where there may be localized areas of bronchiectasis. Now, this is often seen in the context of airway obstruction, which can be from extrinsic factors like a lymph node or from intrinsic factors like a foreign body or a tumor. Or the bronchiectasis could be diffuse, where it is much more widespread, involving all the lung fields. In that case, the bronchiectasis is usually secondary either to an infection or a systemic process. So remember, whenever you have focal bronchiectasis, always think about obstruction, which could be either extrinsic or intrinsic. Now, there are two types of bronchiectasis. Cylindrical or tubular is the most common, and then you have the varicose or cystic, both of which are fairly similar. So essentially, there are three types of bronchiectasis: cylindrical or tubular, varicose and cystic. Although varicose and cystic, as you can see from here, they are largely similar but slightly different. So this is how the normal bronchial tree looks like. This is cylindrical bronchiectasis, where there is going to be enlargement of the bronchial tree in a tubular fashion, and hence it is also called a tubular bronchiectasis. When there are these fusiform swellings, then it is known as varicose bronchiectasis. And when these fusiform swellings become transformed into more well-defined cystic lesions, then it is known as cystic bronchiectasis. Now, what are the different causes of bronchiectasis? So, as I mentioned earlier, airway obstruction is the most common cause of focal bronchiectasis. So, it could be extrinsic or it could be intrinsic. Now, when we look at the different causes for diffuse bronchiectasis, we can use this terminology to remember the different causes. Now, CR stands for cystic fibrosis and post-radiation fibrosis. So, cystic fibrosis and radiation fibrosis. Now, these two can cause upper lobe bronchiectasis. Then, moving on to INN. So, I stands for immotile cilia syndromes, and N stands for non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections. Now, these are important causes of middle lobe bronchiectasis. And then you have the ABPA and congenital syndromes like William Campbell syndrome and Monier-Kuhn syndrome, which can cause central bronchiectasis. And then finally, you have traction bronchiectasis, which is often seen in the context of parenchymal distortion, which typically occurs in idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, or in cases of chronic aspiration pneumonia, which can occur from various esophageal motility disorders like what is seen in scleroderma. So T stands for traction bronchiectasis and S stands for scleroderma. They are important causes of lower lobe bronchiectasis. So this is a good short form, which helps us to remember not only the causes, but also the causes based on the localization of bronchiectasis. So CNR, cystic fibrosis and radiation fibrosis, can cause upper lobe bronchiectasis. And then you have INN, which is essentially non-tuberculous mycobacteria and immotile cilia syndrome, which can cause middle lobe bronchiectasis. And then you have CNA, various congenital syndromes, and ABPA, allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, which can cause central bronchiectasis. And finally, you have TNS, which is scleroderma and traction bronchiectasis typically observed in idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. They are important causes of lower lobe bronchiectasis. So this is a good mnemonic to remember the different causes based on where they cause the bronchiectasis. So let us look at the epidemiology of bronchiectasis. The incidence increases with age and there is a slight female predisposition. Now the onset is going to typically depend on the etiology. So for instance, in cystic fibrosis associated bronchiectasis, there is going to be a fairly early onset, with onset typically observed in late adolescence or early adulthood. And in bronchiectasis following non-tuberculous mycobacterial infections, the most common of which is the MAC complex, the Mycobacterium avium intracellular complex. In such bronchiectasis, the onset is typically going to be later, and this is going to largely involve females who are going to be non-smokers. So the onset and the group which is going to be involved is going to depend on the etiology of bronchiectasis.